So, hello, how are you guys doing? I'm gonna tell you a little bit about myself, but first I wanna talk a little bit about why I believe that the YouTube Creators Institute and the Columbia College Television Department, broadcast, internet, and mobile are a perfect match. YouTube and Columbia College TV Plus, internet and mobile, we both value the auteur or generalist, right? What is an auteur? What is a generalist? Because you guys are all that. But what is an auteur? I ask a lot of questions. There's no wrong answers. I'll lead you to the right answer. But what's an auteur? This is a guess. I want to guess. What's a generalist?
A jack of all trades.
A jack of all trades. See how easy that was? A jack of all trades. So really, the old model, the old television model that Wojtek is talking about, that I actually come out of Hollywood. I come out of the old model, right? Which is, you know, that you get trained with one skill. Like, I was a writer pretty much only. I'm a screenwriter. I'm a TV writer, right? And someone else was the director. Someone else was the editor, right? And someone else did effects, although the effects back then were kind of weak. The idea now, for multiple reasons, not the least of which being that budgets have been cut all the way down, even in traditional TV. Mm-hmm. Now you talk about internet and mobile, and you're literally talking about, and this is a real big estimate, $1 spent on, you know, sponsored internet and mobile compared to $10 spent on TV. So what does that mean? That means there's much less money to pay 10 different people to do something, right? So what the new industry is looking for, the internet and mobile industry, of which YouTube is king, right? What they're looking for are auteurs and generalists, which you guys are. That means you guys, and if you aren't, by the time Wojtek gets through with you in 7 weeks, you will be, okay? And I'm gonna help with that process. Val's gonna help with that process, right? So you guys are gonna be able to come up with your own ideas. You're gonna be able to write to the extent that you need to. How many people are doing scripted stuff? Anyone here doing scripted? Excellent. And then other people are doing, you know, what I call, you know, reality-based, right, which is unscripted. And we'll learn about soft script improv. But they don't have money to hire writers, directors. You guys have to be the writer. You have to be the director. Some of you will be starring in your own stuff, definitely, right? So you're everything. And so Columbia College, Internet and Mobile, that's the people we're going to train. We've only been around Internet and Mobile for 3 years. So next year we'll be graduating the first internet and mobile majors who have been trained in this style to be an auteur, okay? And right now, you guys are being primed and prepped. You know that already, right? You know YouTube likes you guys. You guys got a little foot in the door, right? So the auteur of a generalist. So you, that's all of you guys, right? You put the you in YouTube. Isn't that cool?
Yes.
Isn't that clever?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. All right. So day one, that's for me day one, not for you guys. Okay, I'm here tomorrow with you guys too. We're going to talk about story. Okay, we're going to talk about structure, which wasn't on your program, but you're going to get some structure, because you have to have structure in order to really be able to understand how you're crafting not only an episode, but an entire season, which we'll learn how to craft tomorrow a little bit, okay? And also, yay, character, which is one of my favorite things to talk about, okay? So, some things I've done. See that right there? See that mistake? You see that hairdo? You see those glasses? That's me in 1989. I started out on the Cosby Show. Okay? That's Dr. Cosby back there. Eating freaking Jell-O. Okay? And I also worked on The Fresh Prince of Bel-Air. I worked on Townsend Television, which really sucked. Won 11 episodes on Fox. And I worked on Robert Townsend's Parenthood for the WB. That's what I did before. Right? So then I recreated myself. Okay? And this is some of the things that I've worked on, okay, for the internet. The Omission was a branded entertainment web series and web movie that we did for, and get this, getstdtested.com. And what it was we found our niche for that. We wanted to talk to, we wanted to have a conversation with 18 to 25-year-olds who were notorious for contracting STD, AIDS, and things of that nature. So what we did is we created a story about a punk pop girl band, right, and how their internet-connected relationships, sexual relationships, and just friendships with groupies, right, mirrored the way that sexually transmitted diseases are transmitted. Real quick, what does that mean? That means that when I go on Facebook and I click on to you as a friend, I have access to all your friends a little bit, right? When you have sex with somebody, you have access to everybody they had sex with before. Yay! Okay? So that's Brandon Entertainment. We drove up. It's like we didn't get 500% increase, right? But we drove up internet traffic to that site. Okay? This is something I did with my, that's my wife right there. Okay? And it's called Midnight Monologues. And we did it for YouTube. Just she and I. It's a vlog. I call them story vlogs, though, because she's completely in character the whole time. It's a vampire flick. Right? It's about a woman who, right, has a fascination with nighttime. And she vlogs every night at midnight about the darkness and how she loves the darkness. And she's getting comments and she's getting all these people. And there's one person in particular who calls himself Anonymous, who has the same fascination with night. And she makes a big fucking mistake. A big mistake. Can we curse on this? Edit that out. A big mistake. And what she does is, she does what you're not supposed to do. She goes and meets the guy from the internet, and he's a vampire. And a creepy, nasty, ugly vampire. So anyway, that's something we did. Didn't get tremendous amounts of hits, but I learned a lot about YouTube and how cool it is, and how, I'm spitting, how it's an interactive adventure. You answer comments, you have a relationship with your viewer, right? No one better than this woman here, right? You have a relationship with your viewer, okay? This is something else that I'm working on. Fathom.com, okay? I'm number one, I'm a founder, co-founder of this, but also we do story blogs, okay? So we write original sci-fi crazy content. How Exoskeletons Changed Cage Fighting by Jack Webb. I wrote it, I'm not Jack Webb. But the reason why I mention this is a transmedia enterprise. I'm going to talk a little bit about what transmedia is tomorrow. But we're now developing the short web film for this. And we're developing it into a series. And then we're doing auxiliary content. So really, from the stories that we come up with, we're building internet content. Movies, web stuff. We're doing games. Okay? So this is an exciting world to be in that you guys are playing in. Much more fun than Hollywood. Much more fun. Hollywood sucked. Here we go. Here's what you know from Wojtek and from Michael Niederman. Right? You know, and this is me making a bad slide, Wojtek, but you know good and well that television is evolving. Right? And that's what we see here. We see internet and mobile content as a direct extension of television. And I'm kind of a walking model of that. Started out as a playwright, went into television, now I'm doing internet and mobile, and I don't have one of those yet.
YouTube?
Okay. Yeah. So, we're gonna talk about this all day. This is our subject matter today.
No, it's not.
But Leave It to Beaver, oh my God. So you go way back to the 50s, right? And you've got this show called Leave It to Beaver, number one show, right? Why? I'll tell you why. They found a niche audience even then. What was called a niche. And that, but unfortunately, it was America. Because America wanted to see a wholesome, white, all-American family that gets through all their problems with ease and laughter, and mommy cooks. Right? And daddy goes to work. Right? So we started out with that, but look at this face. You always talk about cult of personality, right? In terms of, and we're going to get more into that. It actually started way back here. You know, the image. This guy attracted people. We want to have a kid just like that. Then we move on, okay? And now we're in the age of what? Of you guys, right? It's exciting. We're in the age of YouTube. But guess what? A lot has changed. What's changed since Beaver? Which you guys probably have never seen. I highly recommend it, Leave It to Beaver. What's changed since you guys were younger watching TV? Number one, most of the episodes are short form, right? Most of what you see on YouTube is 5 to maybe 10, but really 5 minutes long, 2, 3, 1 minute long, right? However, some things have kind of stayed the same. If you look at this, what you see is you see the Guild, which Wojtek just talked about, Felicia Day and her team, right? It's kind of like a traditional sitcom for the internet, except they found their niche audience and they imitate the style and the personality of their audience. They, gamers act like these guys, so they act like them. And therefore, they capture that audience. We'll talk about that even more. Woke Up Dead, anybody ever heard of that? That's because it got canceled from YouTube. I mean, from the internet. However, it's on DVD. It comes from a company called Electric Farm. Write that down. Electric Farm, the reason why you want to write that down is that these guys spend $3 million on a web series. That's what you're not going to be able to do. Okay? But I want you to watch Gemini Division. By this, it's called Gemini Division with Rosario Dawson. Okay, perfect use of, it's all green screen. The only expense is Rosario. She might be worth it, I don't know. Who is this? Anybody know?
Freddie!
Got a real niche market. This guy in 2 weeks will do 3 million hits on YouTube. In 2 weeks. Yeah. I'll show you some of it. And then who, anyone know who that guy is? Timothy De La Ghetto. Okay? Super funny personality. And we'll talk a lot about these guys. These are the four I kind of picked to kind of be our examples today. Okay, so here's what we're going to talk about, okay? Forms. What's a form in terms of what we're talking about? We just talked about how forms change. You have a 30-minute, which is really 22-minute, sitcoms from the old days, or hour dramas. They really were 52 minutes. So forms change. Now, on the internet, most of your content is shorter form. And we'll talk about how that impacts how you create. Okay, short attention span theater. You gotta hook them, you gotta escalate the conflict, and you gotta pop them in the face with a cliffhanger at the end, every episode. And we'll talk about that really in more detail than you really want to go into today. I'm gonna go into that. So forms change, right? Screens. Do screens change? Yeah, we went from like a, you know, the thing we saw before, a console set, which you guys don't remember because you aren't as old as I am.
Yeah.
they changed. Now we're walking around watching them on these. You know, hopefully you guys might have a four. I got like a 3 key. Okay, so you're watching on different screens change. Form change, screens change. What else changes? Oh, well, screens and kind of the next one's kind of a repeat. Devices change. So screens and devices are kind of the same thing. But we no longer connect content necessarily to a device. It's very important to understand because that makes it mobile. Okay? So even if you think you're just doing internet content, right, you're also doing mobile content. Right?
Right.
Okay, so think of, remember, just keep that in your head. That mobile content is consumed as we do what? Why is it called mobile? What does mobile mean? Right. It's consumed in very short time spans, okay? I keep aiming at the monitor. Okay, however, screens change, forms change, devices change. The constant, however, is story. Okay? Story is still what hooks an audience and keeps them coming back. And story is not just in the context of how we understand story before. Okay? Because Freddie, that's story. Right? So it's different ways of looking at story that's different than before, but it really is all still about story. So elements of good storytelling. Okay? Let's talk about this. Okay? It's like a freaking, what you call it? Okay, there we go. Elements of good story. Number one, character. And again, we're going to get deep into character. I'm just doing some cursory jumps right now. Anyone ever seen this, IKEA Heights? Yeah. This woman started doing this web series without being funded by IKEA. Yeah. Okay? She made it herself. She, you know, wooed an audience, maintained an audience, and increased her audience. IKEA gave her close to $1 million to keep doing it.
Wow.
Okay? And really, it's that and that. It's character really that drives that. And you know, of course, it mirrors people who shop at IKEA. Go to IKEA, look around, that's her audience. Plus, okay? Structure! This is biology class now. Structure, that's the skeleton on which you build all content. And if you've been working without knowing anything about structure, I want to clap for you because you've kind of been just like throwing shit at the wall and it's been hitting, kind of, okay? Once you understand structure for the rest of your lives, once you understand three-act structure, you can apply it to film, you can apply it to TV, you can apply it to internet, you can apply it to anything, commercials, 30-second commercials. Okay, so we're going to teach you today, definitely, if I do nothing else, you're going to know three-act structure when you walk out of this room. Is that okay with you guys?
Yeah.
Tone! You see how I got louder? That was on purpose, because my tone changed. So you're like, what's wrong with him? I mean, you know he's kind of trying to be funny, right? Now he went way up here. What was wrong with that, kind of? It didn't fit my character, did it?
No.
So if your tone starts, you're doing a horror movie, okay, or a horror series, a scary series, and episode 3 is not scary, what's the problem there? You've broken tone. The tone of your series, the tone of what you're doing needs to remain constant. Doesn't mean you can't bounce around and have some comedy in there, but it means I don't want to turn on episode 3 and be completely surprised. And you're frowning, because I think I know what you're talking about. Some shows, it'll be one guy will be the host, and he'll go to different fucking environments, and he'll do different stuff with different people. And so how does that work? But you know, it's still him. He or she is the tone of the show. Like Timothy De La Ghetto, he'll play different characters, but it's always Timothy De La Ghetto and his unique point of view about life. Always. It never changes. Even when he changes costumes and settings and locations. Was that what you were talking about?
Yes.
Did I clear it up for you?
Yes, sir.
It cleared up for me too. Thank you. Okay, dialogue. What? I don't know where that image came from. No. You know, we'll get to that. But here's my idea of dialogue. I don't think dialogue can be taught. And people will argue with me about that. I don't think dialogue can be taught. You know why? Because every line of dialogue, whether it's scripted or not scripted, comes from a life. It comes from a backstory. It comes from character. So if you create your characters properly, and we'll talk about how to do that, when they open their mouths, they'll be speaking from their lives. And that's how you get awesome dialogue, because it comes out of a character's history. Everyone in this room, to me, is a character, you know? And you all carry behind you, if you think about it visually, like if something was just trailing behind you, that's your life. And it leads up to the start of your story. Your story, my story today, starts right now. But I'm carrying all that comes from before birth, actually. You know, my parents' relationship, or lack thereof, for me, before birth. All that affects who I am. So don't take YouTube lightly. Don't rip off YouTube from having a real character experience. Okay? People watch her because she allows them a glimpse into her life. Right? And then the paintings, this is me making this up, it might be wrong. And then the paintings are coming out of her and out of her life, out of the story she's telling while she's painting. Right? So I'm sure she sells more paintings, but people are hooked on her life and her point of unique point of view about life. So dialogue is not a character. Setting. Yay, don't we all want to be there? Okay, I take 4 characters and I put them here, and you can kind of make up a story, right? In your head. Just sit them all in that chair, you know? It's kind of peaceful, that story, I think. You know, if they're having fun, I think. It doesn't have to be, though. If I change this to a burnt out, blown up street in Iraq and put the same 4 people there, the setting would change the story.
Yes.
Am I correct?
Right, sir.
Okay, so I don't say any more about that. Yay, The Office, character relationships. The best way to enlighten our idea of who your characters are is to give them dynamic relationships. That put them up against someone or something. And sometimes that someone or something is actually you. Sometimes it's, I'm up against myself and my own thoughts and views. Or it's society. I don't necessarily fit into society. I'm going to talk about that. So my conflict every week is about me and this freaking thing called society. Okay? But you see what I'm saying? So there's character relationships, 99% of which would be you and me hanging out on a video. That's relationships, right? Mm-hmm. Or it gets a little more complex when you're talking about someone who really is just a vlog. It's me and you, I'm talking. Whoever's watching the computer, it's a one-on-one relationship. Some YouTube content is like that, right?
Yeah.
Where it's really just me and you. And it should feel that way. It should feel intimate. Even if it's the midnight monologue that I did. You love her, and then you fucking get really scared of her over time. Okay, so character relationships reveal aspects of character, right? So think about that if you're doing something just with yourself. It's still a relationship. It's you and the person watching. Okay, obstacles, what are these?
Brick walls.
Yeah, they're basically brick walls. You have to have sufficient obstacles, okay? Now, again, let's make a distinction. I'm doing this for you every time, now for me. Let's make a distinction between Freddie U obstacles, guys running at him with guns, right? And obstacles that are much, 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 much more subtle. right? Example. Here, take my pen. Okay. Give it back. Okay. That's a conflict. That's a problem. She's an obstacle between me and my pen. So, thank you. Being an actress, you know, keep escalating it. But you know what? This is what she did. She did that. Naturally and organically. And even I showed her the thing yesterday. No, I didn't. She escalated the central conflict. But real quick, what the hell is a central conflict? And we'll get to that more too. But what's a central conflict? Just guess, please. Somebody.
It's like the speed bump in the road.
Yes. It's the big problem or big question that your episode and most of the time your entire series addresses. Right? And we'll talk about, we'll drill into that because I know that's kind of confusing. How come my entire series, I'm on different locations? We'll get to that. But just think about it. The central conflict is really that thing that we have to get through or solve to get what we want. And we'll talk about need, desire, want, and goal in a minute. So you have, just for now, it's good enough to know there was a brick wall there. And now there's a freaking brick wall with Darth Vader. Is it harder to get through that wall?
Absolutely.
So the next slide, if I was just going to do this forever, would be what? It would be Darth Vader and friggin' something else that's even more difficult to get through. Why? Because we get bored if our characters have everything easy. Okay? Conflict is always about struggle, even if it's verbal struggle. Even if you're, you know, doing something and just talking about something that's conflictual. You know? It allows us to participate and ask one important question that you should always want your audience to ask. I don't have a slide for it, unfortunately, but the question is, what's going to happen next? The second your audience stops thinking, I really want to know what's going to happen next, you've lost them. And me being one of your audience members, I'm clicking to something else instantly. Right? And it's not, I mean, I'm actually a nice audience member. Some people just don't give a flying poop. They want to be entertained. They don't care who you are. Wait a minute. I'm engaged. Let me watch this for a while. And I'm thinking, gee, what's going to happen next? What's that guy, what's that girl going to do next? What are they going to talk about next, right? What guests are they going to have on next? So you start thinking about questions being posed. Because everything, every story is really a mystery. Every single story, every single video is a mystery. If for no other reason, then we don't know what's going to happen. And we want to find out. You know, so if your content doesn't pose some kind of a question or have some kind of a mysterious element, I don't mean mystery like sleuths and music, I'll talk about it more, but I really just mean that your audience is consistently wondering what's going to happen next. That's the mystery. And there's different kinds, and we're going to get to that right about now. Wait a minute. Did I skip a slide? No, mystery. Okay, you all seen this though, right? What's in that box? You don't have to tell me. You don't tell me, but as soon as you saw that on Saturday Night Live, your curiosity was piqued. Okay? Okay. If you get a chance, go to TED.com. TED.
Conference? No, I think it's just TED.com.
Yeah, TED.com and watch Mystery Box. It's J.J. Abrams, who created what? Fringe. He's doing Super 8. He did Cloverfield. He did the new Star Trek. Yes. He's an awesome dude. Mostly because I watched TED.com or TEDTalks.com, whatever it is. Mystery Box, J.J. Abrams. Okay? Let's move on. Audience! Yay! This is part of the fundamentals of good storytelling. If you notice, I'm always including the audience. Okay? So, I'm part of your audience. I hope. Who's that?
Shangu.
She's part of your audience.
Who's this? I love her.
Who's this?
Freddy.
Yeah. And then you can, you know, this is just a joke, okay? Because you really, we're probably not all going to be part of the same niche audience, perhaps. But I just wanted to include you guys for fun. What's that?
Target.
So is this about a store, you think? Is it about shopping? Target? No? Okay. Who are you talking to? And I'm pretty sure you guys talked about this some, right? But short form video, which is what you guys are doing, and short form video series especially, is an intimate conversation between the content and one viewer at a time. Okay, and what I mean by the one viewer, though, again, is what Wojtek was talking about, right? Which is the amalgamation of your niche. You find one person, whether it's Ted or Kevin or Pete or whoever he drew, right? And you drill down even deeper into that idea. So audience is on YouTube.
Could you go back to that slide?
Oh, yeah, sure.
This is good. I'm like, I need that.
If you keep going forward.
This here?
Yes.
Yeah, okay, sorry. Am I moving too fast?
No.
Okay. Short form video is an intimate conversation between the content and one viewer at a time. And of course, that viewer, as you already know, it's not really just one. You don't want one person to watch your stuff, right? But you have one person. It's really an advertising axiom, right? It's about, so I'm gonna give you that real quick in a nutshell. And that is, advertising is really a conversation between two people. It's a conversation between the brand and that one consumer who represents your whole consumer base. And you really have to concentrate on the personality of your brand, right? The blender, right? We're gonna do a new personality. We're gonna just chop blend shit. Smart choice, right? Because it hooked a whole new audience into blenders. So they had that conversation and it brought them together, like any other conversation. If I talk to you for a long time, hopefully we'll get closer. It's the same thing, okay? So audience is, of course, what?
King
and or queen.
Oh,
right. Right. We can all wear the same crown.
What about the ones that are in the middle?
Well, then you got a king and a queen. queen. Traditional TV, internet, and mobile. Traditional TV, as Wojtek pointed out, you're talking to all, trying to talk to all these people everywhere. It's, I want everybody to watch me. Right? And so what you get is bland, flat, dry ass stuff. Because you're trying to talk to everybody, right? So it doesn't work in our model at all, because it's an intimate conversation between the content and one person. That's who you're talking to. And this one, though, is an amalgamation of other people like him or her. You get that when we keep it for a second? One, two, okay, good. This is your niche. That guy, that girl, okay? So let's watch a little bit of this. And I picked an episode that's weird. I picked a video. Are you guys saying yes already? I'm not gonna watch the whole thing. I just want you to take a peek at this. Okay, look at these people. Take a peek at these dudes and girls, right? Let's take it back a little bit. Let me see if I can even handle it. Oh no! Here. I'm gonna pause it on the group, because I want you to look at these people and how much they don't exactly look like people in the street. They're not always in costume, right? I don't think. I don't watch a whole hell of a lot of it. Okay, we'll do it again. There we go. Okay? They're all what? Right now in this scene, what are they looking? What are they wearing?
Video games, costumes, characters, yeah. And video games.
Right. World of Warcraft type stuff.
Yeah.
Okay? All this is, I'm talking about niche market now. For the guild. Okay? Remember Wojtek said 5-10 years ago, you'd have been a nut to try to make this. Right? The World of Warcraft became such a news item in the last 5-10 years. Such a big deal. Why?
People love it
to the point where they're addicted to it. One guy died in Japan playing this. He didn't eat, didn't sleep, and died. Okay? So that's how into this stuff people are. Now, if we were to say that our only audience is World of Warcraft people, I think you'd narrow your audience too much. Okay, the audience that they picked, right, were gamers in general. And aspirational audience members. What do I mean by aspirational audience? People who want to actually have the guts to do that. People who want to be like your audience. People who want to be like your characters. That's an aspirational audience. So they grab World of Warcrafters, they grab gamers, and they grab people within that demographic, which for them is like 14 to 45, okay, who, you know, are interested in and want to know more about this world. Every problem, every relationship, everything in this show, to the most part, has something to do with that world. Okay? We gotta move on because of time. Okay, so niche. Okay? Niche audience. Alright? I wanna talk a little bit more about niche audience. And I'm gonna do it with an example, okay? Made up last night, okay? Because I like vampires, right? But everybody likes freaking vampires, or at least so many people like True Blood. I mean, they're everywhere! God, I'm tired of them. And I like them, right? So if I wanted to create a vampire series, right, that would attract a vampire audience, could I just do like a guy with a widow's peak and long fangs? Oh, that might work. Could I just do like, you know, just a vampire in the street? I mean, we've seen it. So here's my first rule. If it's been done, do it differently. If it's been done, do it differently if you're in the same area. Because here it is, the vampire, right? The vampire audience is I want to get like old people, old ass vampires, right? But what happens when you get turned? If I got turned right now, I'd stay this age forever.
Right.
Okay, I wouldn't be able to go in the daytime, right? I had no blood or heartbeat, but you know, you got to weigh those things. Okay, so. These guys are old. Say they're like 70, 80, 90, right? So that means that they're, you know. But then what else happens when you become a vampire? You get all super and shit, right? So you got these old people who are, and I want them to be like, I want them to attack you and like eat your ass. I don't want them to be nice. But it needs to be a comedy too. So it's a comedy thriller with a geriatric vampire. Do you think I can get an audience with that?
Oh yeah. Oh, yeah.
So I actually stayed within my desired niche. But see, nowadays most niches aren't niches anymore. Once everybody knows about a niche, it's no longer a niche. Right? So you have to create, and everyone here is capable of this. Create your own niche within a niche. Write that down. You gotta do your own niche within a niche. Woke Up Dead, which was mildly successful, but it's a great thing for niche. And what it is the adventures of a reluctant zombie. What's the big niche?
Zombie.
Okay, again though, my God. How many zombie movies and how much zombie content can I watch? Not a lot. They scare me. I get scared easy by zombies. Shit, the movie's funny. Okay, so, but what they did is they said, okay, I'm gonna create a subgenre of that. I'm gonna create the slacker. You know what a slacker is?
Yeah.
The slacker vampire. The reluctant vampire. The dude vampire. And I'm gonna use this guy. You know who he is down here?
Yeah.
From
Napoleon Dynamite.
So what they did, they grabbed all his audience, and then they grabbed the zombie audience, and then they grabbed folks who have that kind of, really it's a gamer slacker mentality. I'm gonna sleep all day and play all night, and somebody will pay my rent. Doesn't work, by the way. I tried it. Okay. Freddie Yu. Love the guy. And I'm not really a big bloody shooter person either. His niche is strange, right? I'm gonna tell you why. So the first niche is what's the big niche? Huh?
People like action movies.
Action, yeah. Really shooters.
Shooter, yeah.
Right, but what's the other niche? He combines two niches.
Special effects.
Definitely. Because he's an effects whiz. I love it. I mean, it's not like really, really expensive effects, but they're cool the way he does them. So effects, shooters, but look at him without the gun.
Nerd.
Asian.
The freaking nerd. And he's an Asian nerd. I hate to be stereotypical, but unfortunately, that's a stereotype. He flips it on its head. I look like an Asian nerd. You're thinking, I'm not pointing at you, you're thinking that it's gonna be a math video. That's your thought because you have these preconceived notions. We all do, because we're fed the notions, right? We see a dread, you automatically assume I'm in a band, and I'm constantly stoned. Okay? But, of course not. So he flips the dynamic, right? Almost every video, you just see him in the beginning. And so really, he's a freaking pioneer. He's a cultural pioneer. Because he's saying, you might think I'm going to do math and science right now, but I'm not. Because he actually is an action hero. He flips around. I mean, he is an action hero. And you wouldn't think it if you start walking down the street. Right? I wouldn't. I can't speak for you guys, but I wouldn't. I think he was, you know, going to math and science camp. And then I would get flipped on my racial issue, which I love. I love the idea of flipping stereotypes. Like him. Who's that? Oh, I love Timothy De La Ghetto. And I'm ashamed of it. Okay, good. Guilty. Tell me something about him. Anybody seen him?
Ghetto.
And there's a guy named Camp Jumba too, who does the same kind of thing. But he is basically, again, flipping stereotypes around. His show, if you put it in a nutshell, the question asked, I said everything has a question, right? Everything has a mystery. What's his mystery? Because he is one of those guys who will go to different settings, different cast around him. He'll be a different character, but he'll always be himself. And the content always tends, when I say always, you can always find one of his videos that doesn't fit my always, okay? But in general, okay, he takes the racial dynamic of what it is to be quote-unquote stereotypically black, which he isn't, right? And he flips it every time. And he also does other things, which I'm going to show you a piece about. It's him and like one of his, you know, actors, and they're actually playing the TSA, the guys who go through your stuff at the airport, and it's extremely funny. It's a little bit sexually charged and very misogynist, so I apologize to the women in the audience for that when we do it, okay? That's who you're playing to, folks. That's who you're playing to. You know? A movie theater is a captive freaking audience. They paid their $7.50 to $10 or $12, and they're sitting there. They're going to sit in that theater probably most for the whole movie, even if it sucks, because they paid to get in. Right? Traditional TV people, they're lazy. They're sitting down. They don't want to change the channel. That's the old model. Your audience is a moving target. Literally a moving target. Right? I call it short attention span theater that we create for. And it literally means that you have to keep an idea. I don't care what niche you find, okay? If you're doing internet and mobile content, people are watching it a lot of time while they're doing something else, right? If nothing else, and I love YouTube, as they're watching one thing, how many choices do we have on the other side of the screen?
At least 15 related videos.
Yeah. Which is wonderful, because one of those might be mine. So I want you to be able to see it, click on it, right? But it also means you have competition from the get-go. And so competition is not just the fact that your audience is on a train, getting ready to get off in 3 minutes. The competition is also that there's other content to choose from on demand, constantly on their phone, on their iPad, on their laptop, or even at home if they've hooked it up to their widescreen. They still have the opportunity to switch away from your stuff. So the viewing experience has changed to one person on the train choosing, the audience is choosing to give you 3 minutes of their time. And they're itching to change the channel because they know that they have this precious amount of time before they get off the train and go jump into their family or before they go jump into their work experience. They value, see, they value you. You provide a freaking service. Okay, write that down. You give a gift. And I want you to start thinking about that. Because you're not charging right now. And even when you start making money off your videos, it's not going to be a one-on-one money exchange relationship between you and the person watching, unless you get a subscriber-based fan thing on another website. If you're on YouTube, you'll be paid through the partnership program, or whatever. I think it's the next program, different program, that will pay you. But your audience member will not have that thing where I just gave you $10, I'm going to sit and watch your shit. No. They're choosing to give you their time, and they appreciate it. We appreciate it. I appreciate it when you give me 3 minutes of quality content. Starts out, hooks me, escalates. I don't get bored. Gives me a freaking great ending if it's a one-off, if it's just one standalone piece of content, or it hooks me for the next one, where I'm going, damn it, I gotta watch the next one. I can't wait till I get back on this train. I appreciate that. So the relationship that you have with the audience should never be forgotten. Matter of fact, you cannot create content in this environment without knowing that you're literally having a one-on-one relationship with each one of your viewers. Very few people I see sharing this shit. I know that on the commercials they have people like crowd around with an iPhone, like everybody's sharing something. When I see it, it's this or this. One person. Right? They made up that thing about 30 people crowding around a 4-inch device. They made it up. Okay. So, short attention span theater has certain demands. Glue, a hook, Beavis and Butthead, and a freaking sheet. Did you get that? No. Sticky. What is sticky content?
Catchy.
Catchy?
Something that sticks in your memory.
Something that sticks in your memory? What else? Sticky, sticky, sticky. What am I talking about? Yes. But I want more. I want you to say something else about sticky. Okay, I'll tell you. In order to be sticky, you need to have a hook. What's a hook? Something that pulls you in. Literally, that's what it is. And so what I'm saying to you is the first 30 seconds of your video, no matter if it's episode 72, but especially in episode 1, has to hook the audience. And what I mean by that is that this. If you're doing a comedy, what has to happen in the first 30 seconds?
You have to laugh.
You have to laugh. If you're doing a thriller, what has to happen in the first 30 seconds? I gotta be thrilled!
Yeah.
Right? If you're doing a piece on how to paint fingernails, what needs to happen? I better see some freaking nails. And they better look good. Or jacked up. So then I can watch you slowly take these jacked up, eating ass fingernails and make them into beautiful fingernails. Right? So the hook for me is the first step of sticky. Okay? And that is that you have to use your content. You have to understand your audience enough to know what they expect. And you got to give it to them right away. And right away, I don't want to make you think in the first minute. I'm first, you know, instant. Because sometimes you want to give them a little second to just say, what is, Okay, so the first 30 seconds, though, you damn well better let me know why I'm there. Right? And that has to do with your tone and your content and your conflict. Next, conflict. Okay? So we talk a little bit about a hook. Strong open introduces central conflict or question. That's your hook. This in textbook language, right? Which I made up this morning. So hook is a strong opening. Introduces the central conflict or question. So again, it has to feel like a comedy. And if the comedy is about a boy who really, really, really wants to meet this girl but's too shy, I need to see the girl. I need to see him walk up to her and not be able to talk to her. Why? Because then I know why I'm freaking here. I'm here to watch him try to woo this woman. So do we understand hook basically? Mm-hmm. We'll drill into it more. Mm-hmm. Do you get it? Good. There's always that guy who just sits there and goes, the cool dude I call. Okay, so then we have what? Conflict. And it needs to escalate. Okay? So, obstacles, villains, problems increase in difficulty. Very important to understand. It has to increase in difficulty as you move forward through your story. I don't care what kind of story you're doing, right? If your obstacle are these jacked up nails, right? And your goal is to make them beautiful, then I need to be excited by the process. I need to see things change and escalate, right? I need to see a mistake. Oh, damn, I fucked up. Ooh, again. Beep! And I gotta go back and do it again. So if I'm a nail watcher, if I'm somebody who watches this nail show, it's not enough just to do it. There's 100,000 nail shows on YouTube. I don't know if that's exactly the number, but there's a lot of them. Right? So you have to find what? I'm going to write this down. It should be, you have to find a vampire. No. You have to find a, here we go, niche within a niche. And who's responsible for creating that? You are. Am I showing my underwear on YouTube? Within a, nothing fancy. I left the lace at home.
Oh.
Maybe tomorrow. Be good. Maybe tomorrow. Okay, so niche within a niche. Again, okay? And then you got to escalate that conflict to satisfy your audience, okay? So again, your central conflict, that problem, again, it can be as little as the nails or as big as saving the world. Just let me know that you're trying to save the world somehow, or that there's a big ass, something scary is coming at me, right? Then escalate it. Escalation, escalation. What does escalation mean?
Raise the stakes.
Right. It means raise the stakes. Exactly. It means put things in jeopardy, even if it's just a nail. So we're talking about a computer there. This direction, from beginning to end. And we'll get into this in structure, okay? But escalation, oh shit, that's escalation, by the way. That's not a niche within a niche. You should have brought your binoculars so you can see what I'm talking about. Okay, and then last but not least is a ram. Last but not least is a cliffhanger or a really, really awesome ending. If it's a freestanding piece of material, if you're only gonna make one of them, then you need to end it with a powerful ending that makes us go, whatever this person makes next, I wanna see it, right? If it's a series, if it's an episodic or serialized series, and I'll define those in a minute, then you need what's called a cliffhanger at the very end. And what is a cliffhanger?
It's something that leads open the story.
Exactly. It's something that puts either someone in jeopardy at the very end, a character's in jeopardy, or you pose a question, another question. And then you don't take the person out of jeopardy, or you don't answer the question to the next episode. And that device, that's really a framing device, right? So a hook is a framing device. You know that every video you make in the first 30 seconds has to hook the audience. And you know that at the very end, the last 30 seconds, you have to introduce a cliffhanger. Again, either put someone in jeopardy, meaning they're at risk, right? He's crossing the train track and we see a train coming. Cut, you don't know if he gets hit to the next episode. Are you going to watch that episode?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Okay, that's what I'm talking about. All right? Okay, good. Video ties. Okay. First, let's talk a little bit about a couple of things before we start getting into scripted and unscripted. And I want to talk a little bit about what's called a situation. It's a situation comedy. Right? What does that mean? If you were to watch The Office, okay, everyone here seen The Office at least once?
Yeah.
Okay, so what's the situation? What's going on in The Office every week? Every single week is the same what?
Chaos.
It's the same location. Right? Mm-hmm. It's the same group of
characters.
And it's the same type of conflicts and stories. Mm-hmm. So the situation is a combination of character, location or setting, character relationships, and type of problem or conflict. If you turned on The Office, right, and there was a real superhero this week that could fly, what would go through your mind?
I would turn the channel.
Yeah, but why would you change the channel, though? Because, I mean, let's say you watch The Office every week.
This isn't what I tuned in for.
America watches episodic or serialized content, which is content, I'll explain the difference, but content that comes in weekly installments in order to be with the same people, the same core characters, and for the example of sitcom, the same setting, the same location, the same types of problems every single week. We get familiar with them. We know them. Right? So in episodic internet content, remember, it's a one-on-one relationship. So the opportunity to really create a situation that's sticky, right, that people want to see over and over and over again, is to your advantage, because you're not creating for a billion different types of people all over the world, really. You're creating for that niche you identified. And so you're creating a one-on-one relationship, right? So your situation becomes something that I go to every week to see your show, or your show, or your show, or your show, because I like to be with that person or those people. I like the types of situations that we talk about, right? If you dramatically change your situation, you're gonna lose your audience. Okay? So as you plan out your series, Take these things into account, longevity. Okay? If you're creating a series and you're only thinking about the first one, you're in trouble. Okay? You have to think about how and what tomorrow I got you again. And we're going to talk about interactive story development. I'm going to talk about some specific ways in which you can involve your audience in the storytelling, but we're also going to do some more structure, because I'm going to teach you how to create a season. And I'm going to teach you an axiom, which I call the rule of three for me. Axiom, in which you can create either 9 episodes, 6 episodes, or 126 episodes, and you'll be able to structure it and understand how to do arcs, how to do story arcs, character arcs. Okay, that's tomorrow. Okay, so I digress. Okay, so situation. Now, episodic. Okay, what does episodic mean? I didn't do the slides for these, sorry. What does episodic mean? I did just tell you, but I'm asking you to repeat it.
Oh. Story, like episode, series?
Right. Every week, sometimes 2 weeks on YouTube, but you better put some making of content, like YouTubeless, in the middle. Because they're expecting something every week. Okay, so episodic means you have episodes, right? The difference between episodic content, traditionally, and serialized content, is serialized content is also every week. However, serialized content, here's the difference. What happens this week directly affects what's going to happen next week. This is serialized. Directly affects what's happening the next week. So if someone falls down the stairs and breaks a leg in episode 2, right, episode 3 is going to have that person breaking a leg. Right? In traditional non-serialized, you really, like, let's say Timothy Delgado. You know, what happened in last week's episode ain't got nothing to do with the next one, except for
him.
His tone and him. And so we come back for him. Right? Okay, so scripted. Let's talk about, what is a scripted piece? What does that mean, scripted?
It has a script.
It has a script. I told you value me.
Hold on. Yeah, leave me right there.
What are some types of scripted content?
Wait, what?
Nikita.
Nikita is a specific show. So what? Our drama is a type of scripted content. What else? Movies are scripted content. What else?
Soap
opera. Soap opera is scripted content. What else? Cartoon. Sketch comedy is scripted and sometimes improv. What else?
Cartoons.
Cartoons are scripted. So what that really means is you have a script, you have a blueprint. The actors, right, they memorize their lines, right, and everyone knows exactly what they're going to do. And and having been on network shows, it takes 8 hours to tape a 22-minute episode because they screw up every 30 seconds. But never mind. So comedy, sketch, sitcom, stand-up. Because a lot of times stand-up is written.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay, not always, but a lot of times. What else? Animation. And then I always put innovation. Because you guys will create things I've never heard of or seen before. So I don't claim to be an expert and know everything. I expect you guys to extend the conversation about what's possible in terms of storytelling in your careers. Right? For instance, auto-tune the news. To me, that blew me away when I first saw it. Because it had real politics, it had music videos, and it had auto-tune. And all together, to me, that was innovation. I'd never seen anything like it, right? My 12-year-old brought it to me. He also brought me Fred, which drives me nuts, even though it's the most popular show ever on YouTube. But I get it, though. I know why people like it. Okay? So, all right, unscripted. What does that mean?
Reality shows.
Yeah.
Spontaneous. Right.
Yeah. Without a
script.
I'm making my money. Unscripted, without a script, which means really you don't have that guidepost. You don't have everything that's definitely gonna happen. You can't walk around and go, okay, I messed up there. Let's go back. Take it back. Okay? It's really harder to do, but it also is more organic. So unscripted content, a lot of times, is about improv, improvisation. There's something called soft script improv. You know what that is?
A general idea and you just go.
Exactly. So if you're doing a reality-based show or if you're Timothy Delgado, you probably don't script all your stuff. But you know, we're going on this basketball court, and this is what's going to happen, y'all. You're going to be playing basketball, and I'm going to come over in here, but what you do is you actually write that down. You write down episode 1 is going to be about this, basically. And it's going to flow like this. We're going to start out with you playing basketball, then I'm going to come ask you some questions, and this is the joke we want to get to, then we're going to go here, we're going to go here. I highly recommend, again, if you're doing a series that's not scripted, that you teach yourself how to outline, and I'm going to teach you tomorrow, okay? All right? That way, you're improvising within a definite framework, and you're going to get to where you need to go. There's something about, you know, having a guidepost that says, you have to get to here in this scene. Otherwise, you can shoot a scene for 12 days and people will never hit the mark you want. Okay? So types of, you know, unscripted stuff. You know, they say reality shows are unscripted, but from being an insider, I'm telling you, they do soft script improv. The producers tell them what they want. They have cameras everywhere. And if you want to get out of here and not be on camera all freaking day, by the time you want to eat, you need to have gotten to this place. And then you can go eat. Okay? That's called motivation, people. So what do they have in common? A lot of things. One thing they have in common is that both types are dependent on audience endearment to character. Okay? Audience endearment to character, even if it's a host. Okay? Completely dependent on the audience having some type of a relationship that they value with your character or host. Okay? Also, all stories are essentially, can you guess what's coming next? Get that, can you guess what's coming next? Okay, never mind. All stories are essentially mysteries. Now, is that true or false? I mean, again, I'm not an expert. I don't believe in experts. Bruce Lee may have been an expert, but if you read about Bruce Lee, he was always discovering more. Right? So the people you see that are superstars, like Will Smith, who I've worked with, he doesn't think he's got it yet. Worked with. I cannot call him, so don't ask me to. He wouldn't know me from a whole freaking ground now. It's been 20 years. But when I remember always learning, always growing, always becoming more. That's what I order you to do. When I say order, it's a very, very little order. I'm not a bossy guy. I want you to start thinking, really, about constantly being a learner, a lifelong learner, constantly growing. Once you think you got it and you're perfect, that's when you screw up. Remember that. I've done it, so remember that. I've screwed up. So there we go. Okay, so every story, whether reality or scripted, has to have an innate question, okay, that will never be completely answered until the end of the series. And that innate question can be very broad. Let's talk about that, okay? CBS Evening News. From an audience point of view, what is the question? Every night at 10, what's the question? What went on in the world today? You can never finish answering that question. Right? That's why news would always be, you never finish answering that question. Access Hollywood, ugh. But what is the question? TMZ, what's the question? What's the innate mystery that'll never be solved?
What's Justin Bieber up to today?
You know, what's happening in Hollywood today? What's happening with celebrities today? And every day we, I don't know, tune in, but to find out what's happening with them. Deadliest Catch, you ever seen that?
Yes.
Freaking addictive. And, you know, these are the guys I would never hang out with. This is like, I wouldn't want to hang out with these dudes at all. But I tune in every week for the question. For the question. What's the question of, anyone? Okay, Deadliest Catch is basically, if you haven't seen it, it's a group of fishermen, crab fishermen, I think it is, and they go out into the most dangerous water you've ever seen. And they're out there, and you're watching them do their job. It's the most dangerous job I've ever seen. And you get to talk to them and know about their families. And so why am I tuning in? What's the question? Will they come back? Right? Or will they be in Davy Jones' locker forever? Will they die? Will they? Because literally they got waves coming up. People get knocked off the boat. Knocked down, they slide toward, they get hooked in the legs. Never mind. You guys don't get it. What's that?
Price is right. Will of Fortune.
Do you see a wheel?
Price is right.
But here's the thing. I did it that last night. I said Jeopardy.
See?
Yeah, I admit stuff. It's a good thing. Learn to admit stuff. Why do we tune in every week?
Who's gonna win?
What's the question? It's very simple. Who's gonna win? And also, there's more detailed question.
Am I smarter than the contestants?
There you go. Am I smarter than, and can I solve it before they do? So this is something, it's interactivity. It's an early form of interactivity. You can't necessarily interact with it, but you're playing along, right? Talk about that tomorrow. Oh, I'm not done, am I? Sherlock, have you guys seen the new? Is the fourth one out? Yeah,
no, not yet.
That's British, and you stick episodes a year. Okay.
Wimps, they can't do 22.
Okay, so, but this is a transmedia property. And you know, we won't really talk a lot about transmedia, but what transmedia really is one idea or concept that's so rich, the world is so deeply built, the characters are so deep, the stories are so deep, the innate mystery is so deep, that they survive forever. Sherlock Holmes started out in, I think, the late 1800s as interstitial, serialized content for a newspaper. A magazine. Sherlock Holmes stories. Then they liked them enough to make novels, right? Then movies, right? And that's when they had the hat, the big-ass hat, and they used to have a magnifying glass and a big pipe, right? But as times changed, Sherlock Holmes had to be re-envisioned, right? It had to be changed to fit the 21st century. So when you look at this, this is the 21st, this is now. It's happening now. But the mythology, write that word down. The mythology is the same, right? The characters are very much the same in the context of the 21st century. So I'm not going to give it away. It's a great show. I highly recommend it. The question, what's the mystery? Now, this is a mystery, right? This is a show about mystery. So it ain't that hard, but you know what else it is? The mystery is for really in this show is, you know, will Sherlock Holmes self-destruct? Is part of what we're talking about in the new one. Just to hook you a little bit to watch the new ones, because he's a lot more volatile, right? He's, you know, he's a kind of a sociopath in a way.
Himself.
He doesn't have any real relationships. He's really kind of bizarre, like, you know, type dude.
It's your house.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, same thing.
Exactly. Right. Great observation. Chopped! Why do we watch Chopped? You know what Chopped is? Chopped is a show on, I believe it's the Food Network, or it's the cooking channel, I don't know which one. But it's basically just, it's a competition between chefs who are like, they have restaurants in different cities, they come like five of them, they're at low levels, they're not like, you know, the executive chef of the Playboy Mansion or something, they're real, well, Playboy Mansion lost its intrigue, nah, I don't know. But basically we watch to see who's gonna win. And we watch to see the judges talk about and beat them up and tell them why their stuff didn't make it. That's the unfortunate part about a lot of reality, is that even the great reality, you know, like The Biggest Loser, which my wife watches all the time, and she ain't that big. Although, nothing wrong with big. But she watches The Biggest Loser. Why? Here's what she tells me. It's just a helpful show. So many people are changed by it. You know, everyone on it, even when they get kicked off, they have a new regimen. A new diet. They're more confident in themselves. And that's true. But you know why she watches it? To see who gets kicked off the friggin' show. That's why she watches it. Don't tell her I said that. I might get kicked off the show. I don't want that. And then Modern Family. I watch it for her. But other people watch it for the real good reasons. What is it about Modern Family?
Ed O'Neill.
Ed O'Neill, great. So we have somebody from a past show, right? That's one thing. So they hook him just like the John Heder character or the Felicia Day character. They come from other things that are already popular. But what else?
Family dynamic.
Thank you. It's in the title.
Yeah.
So you automatically want to watch it if you have a family, or you come from a family. And even if you come from a broken family, you come from a family, right? So you watch it because it's Modern Family, and it really is a slice of the American family. Remember Beaver? The homogenous, very nice and proper white family from 1955, this is what it's become. There's two gay guys who live together, have a kid. Mm-hmm. That's a family. There's the kind of homogenous family in the middle that we all kind of think that would really be the family, right? And people are related in each one, like that's the brother and sister. And then the Ed O'Neill character
actually is married to a woman who's 20 years younger. I think she's from either Cuba or the Dominican Republic. And
Colombia.
She has, huh?
Colombia.
Colombia! Thank you. I don't know if she's gorgeous. And it's her kid. So she brings her kid into the familial relationship. Right? I'm hoping that's worth it. Yes! Okay? The question posed, this is different. Because every week there's a question posed that affects everybody. But there's also a question posed that affects this family unit, and this family unit. So you have A story, B story, C story, D story. Anyway, we'll talk about all those stories in a minute. Different types of stories. Unless I already passed it, and then I ripped you guys off from some good knowledge. Okay, what's the next slide? So what question does your content pose? I want you to add this to your homework assignment that Wojtek gave you. What question does your content pose? Real big question. You guys, are they developing a series?
We are still going to be talking about that, but it's basically up to them.
Okay.
As long as it's structured within our program, and as long as we know what you're making, and
so whatever you're planning on making, okay, I want you to look at what question does it pose. Write this down. What question does it pose? What's the innate mystery? Those two are almost the same thing. And then I want you to also tell Wojtek, what's your niche within a niche? You got that? Will you do that for me? And even if you can't quite figure it out, guess what? That's great. You know why? Because then you gotta drill in and find out. And that might take you a few weeks. You might need some time to develop. You might not get this until week 8. Okay? Or you might get it right now. Oh, my shit, okay, I know what my question is. Good. But we all grab things differently. That's what's great about you guys. Everyone does something different in a way here, if I remember the video. Pretty much everyone's doing something that's different than the other guy, I think. Yeah. So, all right. Talk about mystery. Okay, good. Message. And you're saying, this is YouTube. All right, I don't need a message, Mike. Get out of here. All right, that's what you got to be thinking. This guy and his messages. Right, every video, though, says something about the human condition. Every video says something about the characters in it and who they mirror. Who do your characters mirror? Your characters mirror that. In some way, your characters are giving them what they want, right? So just know that images and words, when you put them together, they teach. Right? Images and words, when put together, they teach something. I don't care what it is. It teaches. So you guys are all teachers. You're giving the world a gift, like I've already before, and it's saying something about the human condition. And I'm not asking you to censor yourself. No. By all means, I'm not. I'm just saying, understand and know that as video makers, right, you're teaching something. What does he teach? There we go. Okay. That was the fun before, like, we got into, like, the stuff I had about. So we're not going to watch the whole thing just because it's, you know, 3 minutes long. What is this teaching?
How to survive an alien attack.
How to, definitely, how to survive a real alien attack. What else? If you drill on a little bit deeper. Remember we talked
self
about...
Self-defense.
Okay. Self-defense.
Or that innate survival humanistic instinct to defend yourself.
Yes. So it's teaching that it's okay to defend yourself if something attacks you. But what else? On a deeper level, a couple things. Number one, we talked about the stereotype of the Asian stereotype, the geek stereotype, the glasses stereotype. So when you start out with this, the first thing you see is what? Him playing the... Which automatically, that's one stereotype broken. He's got soul, right? What's next? Next, we see him. Oh, yeah, you can just go down. Yeah, that's right. He thinks, I don't. That's why we're a good team. I'm like, I'll push this 1,000 times. You don't do it.
I don't know where you're
at. Okay, so he's teaching definitely another thing. And I don't like my son to watch him. I love to watch him. I don't like my 12-year-old to watch him. Because really, every single video is really a shooter. Yeah. So he's basically teaching the idea of, you know, that shooting is fun, right? And I don't have a problem with that for me. He's also teaching that violence can be funny, right? And so in a way, yeah, we're almost there. Thank you, sir.
Sure.
Okay, we're not going to watch it again. Okay? So that's one of, so really it's not just a guy blasting things every week, right? Yes.
And actually, he gave you part of the background because just the scene him playing the harmonica told me he's been in jail.
I love that.
Because
that's the conversation that Freddie you just had with that individual within his niche audience. So he got that. I'm like, I didn't get that, but you did. That's excellent. Now I gotta start investigating. Freddie, you've been in a big house. Okay, now we get a little more serious, but not really. Okay, so if you have a notebook, now's the time. Okay, these things, get ready to use them. Because we have, 45 minutes or so? Let's have some fun with this. Okay? Have a question for you. And really what that question is, you know, comedy and drama are essentially the same thing. Is that a true or false? Comedy and drama are the same.
Yeah.
You say yes? You say yes?
It's a, yeah.
Any no's?
No, I think they're not emerging.
Thank you, Vortex. Not that he's right. But, I'll answer that question at the end of this little part of the lecture in a way that'll teach you something. So, what is drama? It's about conflict, okay? So if we think of drama as like the overarching like mothership of both drama and comedy, okay? I just answered your question wrong, but okay. Conflict is at the heart of that, right? But what is conflict? What is conflict?
The problem you have to overcome.
Pardon me?
The problem you have to overcome.
Yes, the conflict, the central problem, central conflict is the problem you have to overcome. But if you boil down, just what is dramatic conflict? What's that about?
Okay. Two opposing forces. You know,
yes.
The opposite of anything.
Very true. Conflict, in a nutshell, we did the demonstration with the pen. Remember that?
Mm-hmm.
Conflict is really when a character or characters, which could also be a host, okay, has something that they need, want, or desire. Right? That's for you guys to write stuff down. Okay? So, conflict is when characters or character, which could also be a host, want something represented by a goal. Okay? I'm gonna do it up here, it's easier. Okay? So you have a character at the beginning of your story, and they have a need or a want. That's also called motivation. Okay? And it's something they want so badly that they're gonna actually be in your video to do it. And it can be as simple as, she took my pen, I really want it back. Or it can be, we're being attacked by aliens, and I want to save the world. So you have characters, or character, or host. They have a need or want, represented by the goal, okay? And this, my friends, beginning,
middle end. This is the end of your stop or your clip. So you have a need or a want, and that's what it is. Okay? Now what would happen, okay, if I said, I really, really, really want a lollipop, okay? And that's gonna be my video. And someone gave me a lollipop right away. It would be over, and would you be entertained? Would you watch me again? But if I had to go on a quest for a lollipop, right, and at every juncture I hit a brick wall, an obstacle, there was something in between, okay? There's something in between the character and what they want. And it's never just one thing, right? It's a series of things. So there's obstacles, 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 obstacles. Even if it's, you know, shit, I'm locked in my car, I can't get out. Somebody said, I'm locked in my car, I'm out. Okay, now I gotta run up here. Okay, oh my God, they're shooting at me. Okay, the locked door was just as important as the guy shooting at me. And I call the locked door a mini obstacle. M-I-N-I, a small obstacle. The dramatist, which you all are, you might not know it, right? Your job, okay, is to make sure that in this 3-minute episode, and we'll get more into that, right? It's only 3 minutes long, right? But in this episode, right, I have to, the character, okay, and the audience is living vicariously through the character, okay? You know what that means? That means the audience thinks that they're doing this stuff that your character's doing. We think we're doing that. We're kissing the pretty girl. We're shooting the gun. Or a pretty guy, okay? So,
handsome guy, sorry.
So, you hit this obstacle, and you have to what? The character has to think differently and take an action, right? Right? So, the story is the journey of this character overcoming obstacles. The only way to overcome an obstacle is to do something, right? So, you have to take an action to get past this one. And once you get past this one, there damn well needs to be a bigger one. And then a bigger one! And somewhere over here is something called a climax. And we'll talk about that in a minute. And yes, there are jokes around climax. So what is a climax in storytelling?
Where is the decision or the top of everything?
It's the highest point of action. So if you're doing a comedy, it's the funniest moment. What does that mean, guys? That means you never start with your funniest shtick. You end with it. And you're always building towards it. If it's a thriller, then the climax is what? It's your highest point of action. It's your highest point of thriller-type action. It's your highest point of whatever. Whatever your tone is, it's at its height towards the end of your content. And you've escalated to it. And at the very end, we're going to have a cliffhanger that poses the question. This is a motivating, something happens. Or, you know, this is called a catalyst. So something happens in the beginning. We call it a hook, right? At the very beginning of your dialogue, of your content, we know the central conflict. It might be that, you know, something. It might be that we're going to paint a picture about this while I'm simultaneously talking about this. But at some point in the middle, they're going to come together. I keep using you because you're sitting there. Okay? You follow it also. It's very different from an action-adventure. I tend to like to do science fiction action-adventure, fathom, obviously. Question?
No.
Question?
I don't know if this is a good example. But it was kind of like in the movie Hangover, like the original one. The first conflict. Yeah. They wake up drunk, and then next they wake up drunk with a tiger in their bathroom. Next they find out it's like Mike Tyson's tiger, and he's going to kill you if you don't get it back.
That's a problem.
It's like, kind of like that.
Exactly. It's a great, great, great example. You guys should watch that movie together. Avatar has good examples of escalated conflict, too. And we'll talk about that in a minute, okay? So do we kind of get that? There's going to be more. So need, want, and desire. Every character has to have this. Why? Because that's the only way you get motivated. You have to want something, need something, and you're not getting it. Even if it's a question. Even if it's just what's going to happen in the news tonight. Katie Couric is sitting there, and she has to be really freaking concerned with what's happening today. Right? So at the beginning, it's her job to get you hooked in the news and move through that segment. And news writers understand you don't give away the big kaboom in the beginning. You show a dead Osama bin Laden at the end. No, we'll never see that. We'll never see it. We'll never see it. Need, want, desire. They're the same thing. They kind of are. Right? I mention them all just because, they're, I don't know. I always think about them as being the same. But when I'm needy, that's different than when I just want something. If I'm needy for something, that means I need it. I'm committed to it. If I want something, depending on the extreme, how extreme that one is. And desire seems a little more romantic, right? It seems a little, and this is not etched in stone. I'm just telling you how I feel about these words. Desire doesn't feel as urgent to me, but it still is necessary. Want is, you know, I want a candy bar. Really, I do. I love chocolate. But I'm not needy for it. Need to me is I'm broke and I'm fucking hungry. Excuse me. B, I'm broke and I'm hungry. Great story. You can tell a million stories that way. Because why? I'm at a crisis point. Write that down. The beginning of good content has some kind of a crisis point that exemplifies this. Okay? Crisis point means John is just divorced. He lost the house, right? And he's been lonely for a year. And now he's at this reunion. And here comes Monica, who he hasn't seen in 25 years. So his crisis point is what? He's just divorced. He's lonely, right? And he's acclimated to participate in my story. Because he's at that crisis point. He's willing to do anything to get what he at first had a desire for. Then he saw her, he wanted her, and after he talked to her and danced with her pretty close, he's needy. You understand? Okay, let's move on. Motivation. Goal. Again, motivation has to do with need, want, and desire. Okay? The need, want, and desire, I'm repeating myself, I do it for a reason. Need, want, and desire is represented by this. This is what you need, want, and desire. This is the amount of time you have to get it, whether it's an hour and 20 minutes for a feature film, 22 minutes for a sitcom, 1 to 3 minutes for you guys. I say three, you guys might say five. I like short form, okay? It's also three. It's divisible by three, and we'll get to that in a minute. Okay, so what's in between you and your goal? Obstacles. Okay? And obstacles must do what? They must increase in difficulty as we move closer and closer to our climax, which will be right there, to get our goal. So these obstacles start out small, just like your tone does. Your comedy starts out, it's funny. It's funnier. Oh my God, this is hilarious. Oh my God, it's Mike Tyson's tiger. Right? That's a big obstacle. It's too big. It's a tiger. I'd rather face a tiger than a mad Mike Tyson.
Yeah.
They're
both
gonna play.
Yeah.
Right? It's true.
Great. Holyfield can contest to that. But he can't hear you. Okay. So how is conflict resolved? We already talked about it. If I hit this friggin' brick wall with Darth Vader in front of it, if I just stand there, am I gonna get through it? I'm gonna get chopped up. Right? What do I have to do to get through an obstacle? I gotta really figure out how to do it, and then I gotta do it. So action. How is conflict resolved? Action. Now here's the difference between comedy and drama. Okay? They are both basically the same thing. They're all about conflict, right? Mm-hmm. But tone. Comedic conflict, right? Funny conflicts are resolved through taking what kind of action?
Strange.
Strange? Awesome. Yes. Awesome. Tonally, if you're doing a comedy, mm-hmm. talking about tone, and you have comedic obstacles and comedic conflicts, you take what kind of action? Starts with a C, ends with a C. Has an M and an E
comedic
in the middle.
Action.
Comedic. Right. Comedic action. Okay? If you And I say drama now, I'm talking about, you know, drama, thriller, sci-fi, horror. So dramatic conflicts are resolved by thinking, what kind of action? Dramatic, or whatever's in your tone, horror. Whatever your tone is, that's the type of actions it takes to get past your obstacle. So by that model, you can tell the same story two ways. Okay? There's a guy with an axe chasing a girl through the woods. That's your story. Okay? Now, how do you tell that comedically? He catches her, she kicks his ass and takes the axe. In a funny way. Right? Right? And then drags him back to his crazy mama with a mask on. Whatever it is. Funny way to do it. No one really gets hurt. It's funny. Okay? Same exact story. Guy chasing a woman through the woods with an axe. It's a horror movie, though. What happened? Yeah, right, exactly. We don't want to talk about it, do we? Yeah, you do what horror movies do. So that's the same story, told with two different approaches. One is a comedic approach, one is, for us it was horror, but it could be any type of dramatic approach. Same exact story. Turns out different because of the tone that you take and that you're consistent with. Consistent tone. Structure. Time to talk. Act one, act two, act three. Okay? I would write this down if I were in the YouTube Creator Institute. Okay? Also known as, act one is also known as the beginning or the intro or the setup. And we'll talk about why. Act two is also known as the middle, the body, or development or escalation. Act three is known as the end, the conclusion, payoff, or resolution. Let's talk about these really quickly. Beginning, middle, and end. Okay, this is simply how we understand storytelling in the West. Okay, it's plain and simple. Whether it's a novel, whether it's a YouTube video, whether it's a movie, whether it's a book, whether it's even a commercial, we think about beginning, middle, end. Am I correct? When you were in high school, you had to do essays, right? And they had an introduction, right? They had a body in the middle, and they had a conclusion at the end, correct? Same kind of thing, right? What I like to call it, though, act one is setup. Because you have to set up your characters, I'll get into it in detail, and other things that you're then going to develop or escalate in the middle. And then you're going to pay off what you set up. If you plant a gun in a woman's purse in the beginning of your story and we never see it again, did you pay off the gun? So anything you set up in Act 1, you have to develop or escalate in Act 2, which means heighten it, and pay off or resolve in Act 3. Okay? You all have this thing in front of you. You should write on it. Okay? You know, pens? I got two. Anybody?
I took one.
Okay. I usually never have pens. I have them for you guys. Okay, so this is really a feature film axiom, okay? But I want you to kind of step a little bit back and don't even think that it's feature film, okay? I want you to think about it as beginning, middle, and end, okay? I'm teaching you right now really easily three-act structure. And I want you to just relax into it, okay? So this is for a feature. 120-minute film, okay? Here, I know how to make it easier for you guys. Because you're gonna watch that, and then I'm gonna mess around on the board as well. This is a climax right here. This is your end. Okay, this is act one, act two. I'm not just writing the same thing she has, so why is he writing the same thing as her? This is act three. Okay, set up, development or escalation, payoff. All right, right here, okay, it's called the first turning point of your content. If it's a film, it's about 20, 25, 30 minutes in. Test it. Every movie between 20 and 30 minutes in, is a turning point. I'll explain what that is in a minute. Okay, so that's turning point or plot twist. So plot, first plot twist. Plot twist one. Okay? This is a midpoint. In the middle of Act Two. And it's actually what though? It's actually the middle of your entire piece of content. Okay? This is plot twist two. If it's not making sense, it will. Trust me. I'm just taking you through the architecture of it. Okay? And then we go up to that climax. Bam! And then we have a resolution or an ending. Okay? So, here's where it makes sense to you guys. 1 minute. 2 minutes. Second minute. Third minute. For scripted people, page one, page two, and page three. You got 3 pages to do what feature films do in 120. No. Literally, it's a little bit different than that. Okay, but let's talk about it real quick. So, what you have to do in Act One, okay, is that you need to set up your, write this down, characters, main character or characters, host, right? Location, so where are we? Are we on the planet of Tetchwan, whatever it is? Are we in someone's living room? Are we on the street? And then you have to set up the central conflict. What is the big problem? So that's putting on page one. First minute of content. Okay? You guys have to let me know 3 really basic questions. And that is, who's there? Where are they? And what the hell are they doing? And you have a third question, why should I watch? And that's your hook. We talked about that already. Because you're so hooked on my tone and my characters and how they express my tone and on the central problem on page one that you're going to watch to page two. Because you know what's going to happen? At the end of page one, at the end of the first minute, have a plot twist. Okay? I want you guys to really think about this as you architect your video. Okay, so 1 minute into your piece, our brains, because we're raised watching Western content, okay, we're going, where's the plot twist? It's subconscious. Here's what a plot twist is. It's called a turning point for a reason, because things change a little bit. You introduce, write this down, introduce new information, new characters. You change locations. You ask another different question, right? But in some way, because of what happened at plot twist one, act two is slightly different than act one, okay? So the responsibility of the plot twist, and it can be anything from someone just asking a different question, right, to us suddenly being in a spaceship and taking off towards another planet. I'm just doing a different spectrum. But something needs to happen differently, or my Western-trained brain thinks that you're ripping me off. Because it's just the same shit over and over again. Okay? So you move into Act Two. Act Two is slightly affected, again, by what?
Plot twist.
Thank you. I love you guys. I love smart people. Just, Okay. So what do you have to do in Act Two? It's on the board.
Escalate.
Let's talk about that though, because a lot of people don't know how to do that. So I'm going to keep repeating it over and over again and showing you different ways to do it. Okay. So again, what that really means, guys, is we started out with a little obstacle, got bigger and bigger and bigger, got that big there. Does it need to be bigger here? Bigger. Midpoint. Wow. That's gonna be a big plot twist. So midpoint of content is a bigger plot twist than this. Oftentimes, it's when It's a reversal. What's a reversal? What a reversal is that, example, have anyone seen Jaws? The old, old movie about shark attack? If you haven't, it's a great movie, okay?
A long time ago.
You seen Jaws?
Yes.
Awesome! I got him to talk, see? Okay, so, midpoint, maybe it's not the midpoint, but I'll tell you the tweet anyway. The midpoint, it would have been a good midpoint if it's not the midpoint. They think they've caught a reversal, that's what it is. A reversal is, hey, we caught the shark. Remember that? Mm-hmm. They hoisted it up. Mm,
yeah.
That's the shark. Go back in the water. And we, even though we, it's a trick of the mind, we know that 60 minutes or 30 minutes in the movie, 40 minutes in the movie, it's not going to be the end. Mm-hmm. So it's a suspension of disbelief, okay? And we go, oh, they're safe. Only to what? To have a little, no one knows a dog got eaten, right? So the dog, no more dog. Then the little boy on the paddle thing. If you really watch that, Spielberg's a genius. You actually see the pectoral fins come up like that. If you gotta stop it though, you gotta be really weird like me. And when a little boy gets attacked, he's pausing. And you'll see these huge fins roll the real way a great white attack. Scary as shit if you slow it down. Okay, so, but that was a reversal. So it doesn't have to be a reversal, guys. It's a good trick to know, right? So really reversal is you move 180 degrees in the other direction, right? Like, so if we're in jeopardy, oh my God, we're running. Oh my God, we're safe. They can't get in this building. Thank goodness, right? Let's breathe, let's eat, let's start making love. Boom, they get in. That goes back. So if you bring us, or it's, it starts out, everything's fine, and then we're in serious jeopardy, and then we're back to being fine again. So it's literally a reversal. Everyone understand that technique? Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Good. The midpoint have a specific job. And that is that literally your timing should start to increase a little bit. The movement of the story, the beat should pick up. Because you're working towards whatever this is going to be. So as an auteur, creator, some of you actors, some of you writers, all of you directors, right? You need to know that you write to these or create to these points. If you know what this is going to be, you can create content to build up to it. If you know what the midpoint is going to be before you start, which is why we're going to do soft script improv tomorrow, okay, you can create to that point so you know where you're going in little tiny bits. It makes it easier to make something. You know you have three acts, beginning, middle, and end. You know that they're punctuated by these points. You create to get there, knowing it's gotta pick up. Because this plot twist, this is like the monolith of plot twist, right? It's a plot twist again, new information, new characters, change of location, right? Usually what happens here is that whatever you're up against, the character looks like they're not gonna get it. Right? The girl's on her way to the airport. And I've messed up. And I'm in a cab in the Bronx. Then I find her note that says, I really do love you. What do I have to do?
First.
Yes! Act three then is really fast though. So really, we're talking about pacing. This gets a little bit faster. This is like an explosion. Because I know what the climax is. The climax in the story we just talked about is, will I be able to catch her at the airport before the plane takes off? Which we've seen a million times. Why do they keep doing that same ending? I do not know, except it's tried and true. People still go, oh my God, is he gonna make it to the airport? I'm like, yeah. Okay, so this is fast. So really in thrillers, it's really fast. In, you know, docu-series, you know, this will probably be where you really get into the nuts and craziness of whatever you're talking about. This is the height of the conversation, right here at the climax. If it's really an interview or a talk show, right? If it's a game show, then this is where the game gets really intense. And we see who's gonna win, right? Will he get the girl? Can he save the world, right? My recommendation is end it right there or clip it. Don't let me know exactly. Give me the right here, and I'll tell you next week. That's what a clip is. I went through all the struggle to get you interested. I brought you right here. I satisfied some things I set up. But that big question that you want me to answer, you gotta come back next week on me. And audience, we appreciate that, especially on YouTube. I know I do. I appreciate you telling me, here's something for you to hold for a week and think about. And I'll hook you up next week. And then you do have to hook them up next week. We'll talk about tomorrow in terms of how to build a season. Because you give them the answer to that for the episode. At the same next moment, you pose a new question at the beginning of your next episode. That you're not really going to give me the answer to the next one. But we'll talk about that. You know, how to trick your audience. No, how to endear your audience to your story. Okay. We just did that. But I gave this to you for a reason. If you look at your sheet, it doesn't stop right there, does it? Right? It builds downward. Why do you think it looks like that? Exactly. So I've given you a tool that you can make copies of this. Make 50 copies of this for free upstairs in the TV office. If Wojtek can hustle it, you can. Yes, sir.
Well, online there's things called like beat sheet calculators that you can like plug in and like you type in like the length of like a script in like minutes. It'll give you like the exact like page number you should have certain events happen.
Yo, really where is that? See, I always learn something when I teach. If you just, what like, was that,
if
professor?
You
just,
like, if you Google search like beat sheet calculator, you can type in either like the
lifelong learner
minutes or pages you want like a story or a script to be, and then I'll tell you like how long the steps should be. Where like the inside each should be, where the black point should be, the midpoint, the tenfold, the everything.
So everything I've taught you, you really don't need to know. Because there's an app for that.
No.
Innately, like for instance me, I've been writing for 30 years. Everything I get, I automatically see it in terms of beginning, middle, and end. Like I cannot not think that way. And really it helps, you know? I can write pretty much any form because I understand how to structure it. So the beach, that's great to have. It's even better to have that tool in your mind so that when you're just hanging out, you know, maybe you're on the beach and you don't have your device, which is highly doubtful because you guys probably carry these things everywhere you go. I know I do. But you get to know it. So here, I've just given you, you know, intro, main characters, hook, plot twist at the end of that. And this is just for you to have. So the tool is like this. Act one, right? What you'll learn tomorrow from me is going to be a 9-episode season. I'm going to teach you how to create a 9-episode season. And really, just a hint at what that's going to be like, it's episode 1, episode 2, episode 3. That's going to be act one. You know, episode 4, episode 5, episode 6. Plot twist. Episode 7, episode 8, episode 9. Hook. Right? So anything divisible by 3. And I'll teach you that tomorrow. It'll be fun. I like that. I kind of broke that. I twisted it and wrestled it and had me down. And I threw it. Okay? So here we go. Okay, so you got that. We don't have a lot of time. So I'm going to get the character. This stuff is kind of self-explanatory. Oh my God. Yes. Plot twist. Okay, Michael. Here we go again. Plot twist 2. Yay. Right there. Okay.
I know what's next.
I bored you. He knows what's next. There we go. Right before you turn me off, though, I hit you with that.
That's nice. I like that.
Don't lose faith, brother. Okay, character. How to make characters as real as you are, even if they are you. For those of you who star in your own stuff. Short form video is an intimate, you know this already, intimate conversation between the content and one viewer at a time. Right? However, the audience connects to character. Plot is great. The fact that Freddie U blows shit up and shoots everybody every week, that's attractive. But if it wasn't Freddie, if it wasn't him doing it, if it wasn't his unique twist on the shooter style, he wouldn't have 3 million views in 2 weeks. It's very dependent on this one thing. Maybe it's all you know from me today. If you know this and you kind of get it, then I've done my job. Okay? Characters are the human element of story. Okay? And even Ice Age. Because those are personified animals. So they're humans. Right?
I keep remembering your video. Wasn't there something? Never mind. But the, your video was one where you had a stop action. No. Okay. Anyway, moving on. Someone else. Okay. But I was just getting to the point where, you know, really characters don't have to be human to be humanized, to be personified, right? Because even this chair, if I really wrote a good story about these two chairs falling in love, I could make you cry. Seriously, I can do it. I'm not going to try to do that, but I could. Okay? What's important about that, though? We'll get to this again. In terms of characters. What's important about that, you guys ever hear of what's called universal human themes? Universal human themes, regardless of language or geographic location, are the things that all humans kind of have in common, right? We all have the need to be loved in some way. And even the rejection of that need as a response is a need for love. It's just that, you know, I've been hurt, so fuck you. Right? So I keep saying this word. Are you guys gonna beat me out? I'm sorry. But I'm like 45, I tend to curse. Okay? So universal, what are some more universal human things? The need to be loved, what else? If someone killed someone you loved, you'd have a need for revenge. What else? If you didn't know, and this is me, but you didn't know who your father was, you'd have a need to
find
an idea. Okay? If you didn't have, so universal human needs are things that regardless, again, of cultural ethnicity, regardless of geographic location, in some form in, you know, the tribal Africa, right, that 7-year-old needs to be loved by his mother as much as my 12-year-old needs to be loved by his mother. So if you can kind of isolate universal human themes and you kind of connect those to your content, right? It can be the need to shoot people as they run at you. The need to get your steam off by shooting things. That's it. That can be a need. Some people have that need all over the world. Unfortunately, they play it out for real in different parts of the world. Close to here. But okay. So scripted versus unscripted. Research that though for me. For yourself. I'm not going to ask you to bring anything in. Write down universal human themes. Also write down the hero's journey, okay, by Joseph Campbell. And it's all kind of stuff, even on YouTube with that.
What was it again? Sorry.
The hero's journey by Joseph Campbell. So characters, scripted versus unscripted characters, okay? Scripted characters must have, and the thing about this, what you'll notice is they both need almost the same things. So it's not like they're very different, okay? But characters must have lives, right? Harold Pinter, a British playwright, wrote something called The Homecoming and many other famous plays. He had a quote that I use all the time, and that's every line of dialogue must be connected to a life. Every line of dialogue must be connected to a life. So what does this mean that characters must have lives? Are characters real? There's no wrong answer, just spit it out.
You should feel that they are.
Thank you. If you're the creator, you should definitely feel and know that they're real. And if an audience member is watching, they damn well better feel that they're real. Now, real may be Freddie Yu's real. In his world of first-person shooter action, he's a real guy in that world. So it's world contingent. Because I kind of know that there's no Spock. Right? Dr. Spock is not like going to walk into my house and knock on my door. But when I saw J.J. Abrams' new Star Trek and I found out about his life, I found out about his backstory, I found out about the fact that he was a human and Vulcan hybrid, and that in his culture, that's like the lowest on a totem pole, to be part human, and that his mother was human, and that they always put down his mother, and that he wouldn't take that shit.
Right.
I gained a lot of respect for him because of universal human things. If someone talks about your mother, are you going to be happy about it? So what J.J. Abrams did is what? He took a universal human thing, the need to protect mother, and he stuck it into a character we already know and love, and he
recreated the franchise by doing so. Same thing with Captain Kirk. And it's all about universal human themes. So again, do that research. So characters must have lives. How? Backstory. What is backstory? Oh, that was no fun. Let's do backstory now. We don't have enough time for more later. We're moving faster because we gotta be out of here in like 20 minutes. So, it's because you gotta go to the bathroom. I gotta get a bathroom break. Never heard such a thing. It's not in my contract.
Crazy.
Not in my contract, man. Okay, so backstory. What is backstory? That's backstory, okay? But really, in terms of, you know, what we're doing, backstory is everything that happened to your character before your story begins, right? Everything that your character's bringing with them to the video. And if you haven't given any thought to that, then I can guarantee you probably have two-dimensional characters. You don't have any depth. And when they speak, you're speaking. They aren't. And an educated audience, and YouTube audience, is educated with YouTube videos and all other types of content. They have a million, billion, trillion choices, okay? So they're looking for characters who have some depth. So when they open their mouths, they're speaking from experience. They're speaking from what they've been through, right? So how do you do that, though? How do you dig back into a character's life? It's actually pretty easy. You know why? Because in this axiom, you're playing little g God. You're creating people. Write that down. You're not creating characters. Okay? You're creating people. Even if they're animated dogs. Or if you're doing a dog video, then you're creating something that's going to speak to people. It's going to evoke an emotion. The dog doesn't need backstory, right? But you need to understand that your audience, that niche within a niche, they have backstory. And if they're watching your dog video, more than likely their backstory includes a dog. Very good. Thank you. I like him. Yeah. Okay, so backstory, real quick. Core personality. Okay? Core personality, what is that? Okay, you do what's called a character bio. One page. Can be more than that. And really what we're going to do is you're going to step back into your character's life, okay? I like to go, and I'm nuts though, I go all the way back to what was the socioeconomic and relationship situation of the parents before they were born. Why would I do that? Why would I go way back to before the guy was born and what his or her parents' relationship was like?
It has a lot to do. It impacts a person.
It impacts a person, okay? The guy born to a mom and dad who get along, and who are financially secure, and I know, oh stop it, it's not true, I know. No, that's the Bieber family, right? Leave the Bieber. That guy or girl has a different beginning of life than the guy born to a crack addicted mother, right? In Sarajevo, right? In the hood of Sarajevo, right? Those two people, because of the situation they were born into, right, are gonna have a different start to life. Then we move up quickly though. You can do one page. You can start with the family, the parents, right? Then when they're born, what is their familial setup? Are they brothers and sisters, right? Is it a poverty situation? But more importantly, what are the familial relationships like? Does the character have a positive or negative relationship with his mom, with his dad, with his or her siblings? Right? Why would that matter though? I mean, we're doing a video, it's 3 minutes long. Why does that matter? And in some of your cases it might not matter that much. Yeah.
Backstory determines how characters like decide and make actions.
Perfect. If I can make that a slide, I would. One more time.
Backstory is like how you determine like why a character, it's how you explain a character's like actions and decisions. It's like all the past experiences influence what they do at that present moment.
So if you don't know those,
you can't write how they act.
You can't write how they act. You can't make a decision for them. When they hit this first wall, if you don't know where they've been, you have no way of knowing how they're gonna get past here. And except to fall back on what you've seen a million times other people do. and then we get to the area of what? Boredom. Click, 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 bye-bye. Okay, so backstory is so important. Okay, I'll move real quick. Right now, we're like that far through one page, okay? Then we move to the next stage, is the formative years of being a friggin' teenager, high school. Why is that so important? What happens in high school? What changes?
Us.
That's very true. How? Don't be shy.
Start learning how to interact with other people. And
that should start in grammar school. I skipped that. That should start earlier. But yes.
Puberty.
Puberty. Why is puberty so important besides the obvious physical changes? Why is puberty very important?
Just mentally, just start taking, like shaping your own way of thinking.
Right. Your adult person persona or what's the persona? What's the personality? What's the difference? Personality is what you really are. Persona is what you show other people. Right? And it's good to know that because you jump between the two in a piece of content. There are moments when the audience gets to know you, the core personality, and there are moments when they're only going to get your persona. And the way you dance back and forth between those is very, very important. It's part of your story. Part of everybody's story. Part of my story. I'm not telling you anything about me. Right here, right now. I'm teaching you with my teacher face. Right? I'm not much different than this. But there's some shit I haven't told you. So if we were doing a drama about me, I don't recommend it. I do not recommend it. You know, I would take you home. I would go to my mom's house in the hood. I would let you see where I come from a little bit. And then you would understand what affects me now. So if you don't do that same work, remember, you're making people. And if you think you aren't, then either one or two things is happening. You're boring people to death, or you're real lucky. Because you're doing it innately without knowing it. Episodic characters and hosts never change, almost always. It's just something to know. If you watch Modern Family, those characters aren't going to change ever. They're going to go through what they go through by the end of the episode. Guess what? They're going to be the same. A lot of episodic content is like that. Serialized content, however, is a little bit different because what happens in the episode before actually affects what's happening in the next episode. So the ability to have what's called a character arc. What's a character arc? It's how the character changes from the beginning of content until the end of content. Whether it's an episode, it's usually a season that you actually see a change in a character. It's hard to change a character in an episode, although you can. How do characters change? How do character arcs come about? Because you have to face that brick wall. You've got to think differently. Right? Who said that? Who said think differently? Make different choices. Right? And by making different choices, because you got to get around the obstacle, you are changed. Right, actress? Right? Okay. Tone and situation in episodic content. They don't really change. Now, with the exception of the idea that situation is tied to location does change in the stuff we talked about, where Timothy De La Ghetto is always Timothy De La Ghetto, and the real situation is his take on the world. That never changes. But he's not going to be in the same room every week, like The Office. He's not going to be in the same four sets. He's going to jump around everywhere. But really, so with him, tone and situation don't change either. But we have to look at situation a little bit differently. It doesn't really include location, right? But like the old model for sitcom was you got three standard sets you see every week, one swing set. Which means you can change this one. It can be a cab, it can be a car, it can be another bedroom. But the situation is these characters in these three rooms. Okay? And you see that played out still on TV. You see it played out still on YouTube. Because audiences endear themselves to character tone and situation. Some you know, the old pitch was, the old idea in Hollywood was, never pitch a show about the DMV or the IRS office. Why? No one wants to freaking go to the IRS office or the DMV every week! Okay, so tone situation, and this is gonna be a lie. Wait a minute, where is it? Never change. We just explained how they sometimes change. Unscripted. Yay! Cult of personality. You already learned something about that. Right? But really, when you dig really, really deep into unscripted content, I don't know who she is. Okay? The host
is the niche within a niche. She is the niche within the niche of the art video. The fact that she's painting isn't what makes her show special. She's a great artist, great artist. That's not what makes her show special, though. What makes her show special is her. You ever watch Val's Art Diary? Watch it some more. Watch the Coca-Cola one, you know? Watch it some more. And realize that what's really happening is a beautiful con job. You're being lured into her personality, right? And that colors, and kind of in a good way. That, because everybody here is, everything you just learned is about manipulating your audience. That's what I mean when I say con job. It's not a bad thing. It's what we expect of an audience. I want you to manipulate me. They're tuning in to listen to her, watch her, see her, and see her unique point of view about life. I didn't know you were going to be here either. So I'm not playing to her. Okay? So again, how many people are doing unscripted? How many people are doing like reality-based? So whoever that human being is, right, you're going to have a general niche, vampire, that we talked about, right? And then that host, that character, that's your niche within a niche. Timothy De La Ghetto is his niche within a niche. Because there's three other guys who do almost it. Kev Jumba almost does exactly what he does. And he's great at it. But he gets more, that's not him. Timothy De La Ghetto gets more hits now. And the reason why is because of his personality. It's a cult. We're cult members of the Timothy De La Ghetto, at least I am. Cult of personality. Differentiation. What is differentiation? Remember I said, if it's been done, do it differently?
Yeah.
That's what I'm talking about. What's a brand? Because all of you guys are building brands. All of you guys are building brands. A brand is the idea that, it's a transmedia idea, really. But what a brand is that it's the specific and unique way that you have that conversation with your audience. It's represented by logos, it's represented by the content that you create, and it's represented by the way that you interact, answer comments, ask for subscribers, give them auxiliary links to content, okay? You're building a brand, and people have confidence in a brand. I don't even like Dunkin' Donuts, except for I go there every week. But if someone said, what's your favorite coffee? I would probably say Caribou Coffee, okay? But guess what? Not only, they're everywhere, number one, but number two, this is dependable. I know I can get it when I get off a train anywhere in the world. I know the service that I'm gonna get, which ain't that hot, but it's quick, right? So their brand is not just about, they don't even sell donuts hardly. They sell ice cream, breakfast, lunch, you know, and then there's donuts. But they've taken their brand from being about time to make the donuts, remember that? Maybe you don't. To, what is it? America runs on Dunkin'. So why do I talk about that with you guys? Because I say every single YouTube channel is a brand. Some of them don't look and feel at all like any type of a brand. You know, I know everybody can't do branded. Everybody can't put stuff all over it. I think you have to have special permission to do that, or anybody can do it. I don't know.
I think you have to.
Yeah, but you can create content, the look and feel, the consistency of the tone, the way you talk to your audience is your brand. Timothy De La Ghetto has a brand. He has a certain look. Those aren't real glasses. They don't have any lenses in them. Niche. We talk a lot about that. So your brand speaks to your
niche.
Right. Your idea speaks to your
niche.
Your character speak to your
niche.
Thank you. We already answered that. I'm way ahead of myself. We already talked about this, Michael. But here, you actually will be able to go to the bathroom. I really got through all this. Okay, but backstory, the life and struggles of a character before your show begins. Right? Oh, this is great. So another reason why we need desires, needs, and wants, okay, there's two areas of that. One is that your audience should have similar desires, needs, and wants as your characters. Okay? And just do that test in your mind. different things that you really, really like, right? And the reason why you like it is because you're living vicariously through the characters and you want to do what they're doing. Or you really don't want to be in a situation because they're being chased by, you know, or whatever, but you want to witness it. And you say, oh my God, I know he's in the closet, right? If I was there, I'd run, right? That's why there used to be no horror movies with black people in it. Okay, never mind. Because as soon as that monster popped up, I'm gone. Okay, so desires, needs, and wants also create what's called character curiosity. So you can't have this without your character having this. All characters need to have a curiosity about what they're doing. Okay, that's what need, want, and desire is, right? It's curiosity. So your audience has the same basic curiosity, really, as your character. Got that? Visual description implies character. So if you're writing a visual description, I always say, you know, tell me the character's name and the age, then give me one to two lines that describe what they look like, but it has to imply character, okay? So in other words, if I open up and I have a guy, okay, you know, 5'11", well-groomed white guy walks in with a coat and tie and a briefcase, okay? What is your assumption about that guy? I mean, really, I mean, that's, you know, what's the assumption? I'll tell you mine. I assume that he's college educated, that he's gonna tell me something I need to know, or sell me something I don't need, but that he's a man of respect. Why? Because I'm brainwashed that way. I think that those guys do that. I really don't anymore. I think they're serial killers. But anyway, that's the media, right? But really what it is that here's the opportunity for creators. And that is that when you give a visual description, when I see your character, I make an assumption instantly about them. Your job is either to pay off my assumption and he really is that guy, or he opens up his briefcase and pulls out a gun and robs us all. Guy that never went to high school, never went to grammar school. Career criminal. Just got a nice haircut after getting out of jail and stole somebody's suit. And we all believed him because of what he looked like. Right. So it's either pay it off or mislead us with visual description. Naturalism, we gotta talk about that, right? Talk about naturalistic dialogue comes out of a life. Do your backstory work. Know who they are. Unscripted characters must share a truth about themselves and their unique take on the world. That truth is there because it depends on the world. But whatever it is, you gotta share a truth if you're when you're unscripted. And it can be a made-up truth. It's gotta be true for the world, right? And it needs to be consistent. Character relationships. Okay, again, I'm glad we talked about all this stuff. Yeah, well, I'll be done in 5 minutes, Vortex. Right. So, scripted characters and unscripted characters, both are dependent on character relationships, even if, as you asked me, one of you guys asked me, it's you and you, but it's not. There's somebody else that you have a relationship with. Who is that?
Mm-hmm.
Yes, but who? if you insist. But no matter what, who's the relationship with, if you're doing a video?
The audience.
Thank you. Structure is the skeleton that you build your story on. Really it is. And we talk about structure today. Try to memorize it. And you can just start building things on it. Right? I learned that from Legos, by the way. Okay. Character is the human element of the story. I'm wrapping up on it. Character is the human element of the story. Audiences connect and come back for character. A video must have, a video story must have, endearing characters or hosts. I mean, the audience needs to care about them. One of the best ways to do that is make sure that they speak to universal human themes. Has to have an escalating conflict or struggle, right? Beat some butt heads, right? In other words, you start out small, whatever your tone is. If you're a comedy, I'm a giggle in the beginning. I'm going to like it, but I'm going to get funnier and funnier and funnier. Okay? A mystery or a question not answered until the end. And again, that's what my assignment is for you guys for tomorrow, is to come back and tell me what the mystery or question is in the content that you're going to be making in these 8 weeks. If you can't, that's fine. I want you to think about it. You have to have a resolution, ending, powerful, boom! Especially for standalone content, and you must have a cliffhanger for episodic, which means you have to hook me so that I want to come back in some way.
And then I had homework, which is not really your homework, because I don't think I'm going to give you any homework. I think Wojtek already has. But these are some things for you to think about. Because really, you ought to be able to pitch your series or your idea in 1 minute.
Okay.
Okay? It ought to include your niche audience, who you're talking to, the mystery or question posed, right? Who are your characters and hosts, a little bit about their backstory. And what should just, you know, after you do that, what should just be evident, but you definitely ought to be able to tell me, what makes this show unique and different from similar content? Okay? Thank you, people. I appreciate it.
Thank you.